Husband. Father. Athlete. O.J. Simpson.
Now police radio is saying that Simpson has a gun at his head. Police radio is saying that Simpson, the passenger in the car, has a gun at his head.
Oh no.
Which has explained why they haven't been stopping and why they haven't moved up alongside.
Oh no.
The voice saying, oh no, is John Mack, president of the LA Urban League. If you've just joined us, this is Larry King live in Washington. Reviewing a call.
O.J. Simpson became a household name during his time at the University of Southern California. While there, he won the 1968 Heisman Trophy and was eventually drafted first overall in 1969 by the Buffalo Bills. His career in the NFL was nothing short of legendary. Simpson was the first player ever to rush for 2,000 yards in a season, a feat that has only been accomplished 7 other times in the 50 years since. And by his retirement, he became the number 2 greatest running back of all time. Nearly 50 years later, he is still in the top 10.
You can't touch this. You can't touch this. You can't touch this. You can't touch this.
In 1983, Simpson was inducted into the College Football Hall of Fame, and 2 years later he made it into the Professional Hall of Fame, where he remains included to this day. Simpson also starred in numerous movies and television shows, including the highly successful Naked Gun franchise. Most notably, O.J. Simpson starred in a television show called Frogmen, where he was trained in knife combat a mere 3 months before the murders. O.J. Simpson's fame and popularity from football no doubt had a massive impact on the publicity of this trial, especially in an era without social media. In 1985, Simpson married Nicole Brown, who he had met 8 years prior. Simpson and Brown began a relationship while he was still married to Margaret Whitley. The same year he married Brown, he was inducted into the NFL Hall of Fame. Brown and Simpson had a very tumultuous relationship, highlighted by the birth of their 2 children and a spousal abuse charge, which Simpson pled no contest to. The pair got divorced in 1992, but attempted to reconcile in 1993. His fame and legacy would be the reason he got into the public eye, but not the reason he would be remembered.
So, how do you think the mass media coverage influenced either the people's perception about it, or how the verdict changed? Like, do you think if there wasn't so much media coverage on it, would it have been different?
I mean, I don't think so, because, I mean, the jury was supposed to be, like, sequestered and not have any, you know, influence from the media. I think just, like, the general public, I would say most of them made their decision probably before the trial even happened. Like, they had it in their head, either, like, oh, you know, like, I really liked him as a football player or whatever, like, there's no way he could have done this, or, like, oh, absolutely, he killed him. He killed both of them.
Cause you can, you won't, and you don't stop. Cause you can, you won't, and you don't stop. Or when you can, you won't, and you don't stop.
Might be coming back for sure.
On the evening of June 12, 1994, O.J. Simpson and Nicole Brown attended their daughter's dance recital. After the recital, Brown and several family members went to a restaurant called Mezzaluna. A little while after leaving, Brown's mother called the restaurant about a pair of missing glasses. Brown's friend, Ron Goldman, retrieved the glasses and took them with him as he left the restaurant for the night. It has never been known what happened next, but at 10:55 p.m. that night, Brown's dog was found covered in blood and walking in the street. Around midnight, a couple was able to retrace the dog's steps back to Brown's home, where she and Goldman were found murdered at the front of the house. While accounts vary, neighbors say that they heard a male scream around the time it is said Brown was murdered. Goldman's parents believe Ron arrived with the glasses while Brown was being stabbed and tried to stop it. Unfortunately, both Brown and Goldman were stabbed brutally. Forensic investigation the next day found a blue knit cap, a black leather glove, and the envelope containing glasses that he was returning were all left at the scene. That same night, Simpson was scheduled to be picked up by limousine at 10:20 to board a red-eye flight to Chicago. The limousine driver reported seeing a shadowy figure enter the house around 10:40, and Mr. Simpson entered the limousine a few minutes later, claiming he overslept. Notably, Simpson kept a knapsack with him that he would not let anyone touch. However, once Simpson boarded the plane, the knapsack was nowhere to be found. It is believed that the evidence from the scene, including the weapon, were in this bag. Once the police identified the body as that of Nicole Brown's, they issued an arrest warrant for Simpson based on probable cause, including the blood on his front door handle, an askew parking job, and a history of domestic violence. The police called Simpson in Chicago to inform him of Brown's death, but all he seemed worried about was whether or not their children saw the murder. When Simpson was finally brought in for questioning, police noticed a cut on his hand matching a cut on the glove left at the crime scene. Simpson was not able to provide a reliable explanation for where he got the cut. Finally, on June 17th, detectives officially recommended that Simpson be charged with first-degree murder. When officials came to the house OJ was residing in, he was nowhere to be found. An APB was issued, OJ was officially a fugitive, and the memory of what happened to Nicole Brown and Ron Goldman would live on forever.
I believe I can touch the sky. I think about it every night and day. Spread my wings and fly away. I believe I can soar. I see me running through that open door. I believe I can fly.
At 5 p.m., Robert Kardashian, Simpson's friend and eventual lawyer, read Simpson's supposed suicide note.
To whom it may concern. First, everyone understand, I had nothing to do with Nicole's murder. I loved her, always have, and always will. If we had a problem, it's because I loved her so much. Recently, we came to the understanding that for now, we were not right for each other, at least for now. Despite our love, we were different, and that's why we mutually agreed to go our separate ways. It was tough splitting for a second time, but we both knew it was for the best. Inside, I had no doubt that in the future, we would be close, friends, or more. Unlike what has been written in the press, Nicole and I had a great relationship for most of our lives together. Like all long-term relationships, we had a few downs and ups. I can't go on. No matter what the outcome, people will look and point. I can't take that. I can't subject my children to that. This way, they can move on and go on with their lives. Please, if I've done anything worthwhile in my life, let my kids live in peace from you, the press. Don't feel sorry for me. I've had a great life, great friends. Please think of the real OJ and not this lost person. Thanks for making my life special. I hope I helped yours. Peace and love, OJ.
Simpson and his friend Al Cowlings embarked on the now-famous Bronco Chase and were first spotted by police at 6:45 on the I-5 freeway in Los Angeles. Cowlings alerted the police that Simpson had a gun to his head, slowing the speed of the chase down to 35 miles per hour. News helicopters eventually found Simpson as well, and the chase began a national spectacle. The chase ended at 8 p.m. when Simpson stopped at his Brentwood house. He waited in the Bronco for 45 minutes and then went inside to speak to his mother. Simpson surrendered to police once his lawyer, Robert Shapiro, arrived. Police found $8,000, a loaded gun, a passport, and a disguise kit in the car. Where were you when the O.J. Simpson car chase was happening?
I remember that I was driving to my dad's house. Well, I wasn't driving. My dad was driving to his apartment on 54th Street, where he lived with my stepmom. So we got there. The chase had been going on for some time, although it was in L.A., so there's like a three-hour time difference. And so I remember just watching the car in the driveway and just checking in. Every so often we'd flip back and go, yep, the car's still in the driveway. Anything? Anything? No. That was it.
How do you think O.J. Simpson... Do you think he took the right approach for when everything came out? He was like dodging a bunch of police officers. You know, he played into the part of the criminal.
Yeah, that's never the right approach. I think that solidified it for a lot of people. Like, oh, if you're gonna run from the cops, you're guilty.
Yeah.
O.J. Simpson awaits his arraignment on Monday on double murder charges that could bring him the death penalty. Authorities have him under a suicide watch, and his attorney Robert Shapiro says he's never seen Simpson more depressed.
O.J. Simpson remains behind bars tonight in a special wing of the Los Angeles County Men's Central Jail. He sits alone in a 9-by-7-foot cell, much like this one. Once a day, he's brought to a jailhouse exercise room for a brief workout, alone. Every other day, he's allowed to shower, alone. Tonight, O.J. Simpson, once beloved by millions of fans, faces his toughest battle yet, alone.
It's a modern story. It's of course, the biggest tragedy because two people were killed. Children were robbed of a mother. Families lost loved ones. And a man widely admired in this country is now caught in the web of a terrible tragedy. But I have to say that after we all watched it in excruciating detail last weekend, the time has now come for the legal process to take its course. I think the less the rest of us say from now on in, until the legal process takes its course, the better.
There are more procedural hearings on the double murder charges tomorrow morning. And while Simpson insists that he is innocent, Los Angeles authorities are now saying that parts of his story are beginning to unravel.
The trial against O.J. Simpson began on January 24, 1995. The trial was held in downtown Los Angeles, which in part resulted in a jury pool that was primarily African American. Judge Lance Ito selected 12 jurors out of a pool of 304. However, by the end of the trial, only four of the original jurors remained due to a variety of dismissals. Selection of the jury was difficult because those with an education were more likely to believe DNA evidence, African Americans were more likely to believe a case built on police brutality, and women were more likely to be biased against Simpson's prior domestic violence charges. Problems arose when Ito dismissed three jurors based on a claim of racial division inside the jury. This led to protests where 13 of the 18 jury members refused to come to court. Judge Ito ordered them to come, and in response, 13 members were all black. This was described by the media as a jury revolt. Both sides of the trial had strong legal teams. The prosecution consisted of Deputy Attorney General Marsha Clark and Christopher Darden, alongside prominent lawyers Hank Goldberg and William Hodgman. The defense for O.J. Simpson consisted of what would be known as the Dream Team. The team was first led by Robert Shapiro, with Johnny Cochran taking over later on. Other notable lawyers included attorney F. Lee Bailey, Robert Kardashian, and Alan Dershowitz. It is estimated that Simpson's lawyers cost him anywhere between $3 and $6 million, and the prosecution's lawyers cost taxpayers $9 million. The prosecution argued that Simpson's history of domestic violence led to and finally culminated in the murder of Nicole Brown. The prosecution opened by calling Sharon Gilbert, a 911 dispatcher, and played a 4-minute 911 call from Brown.
911 emergency.
Can you get someone over here now to 325 Gretna Green? He's back. Please.
Well, okay, what does he look like?
He's O.J. Simpson. I think you know his record.
Thank you.
locked in a room or something?
No, he can come right in. I'm not going where the kids are, because it's for sure.
But you think he's going to hit you?
I don't know. I just...
Okay. Stay on the line. Don't hang up, okay?
Pictures of Brown's face shown from that night proved that Brown was beaten severely and bruised. The prosecution planned to present 62 incidents of domestic violence during the case. However, this part of the case was eventually dropped as the prosecution believed that the DNA evidence against Simpson was already insurmountable. The prosecution put forward lots of DNA evidence, including blood matching Simpson, Goldman, and Brown inside Simpson's Bronco, leading from the Bronco up to Simpson's house and on a pair of socks found in the Simpson house. The prosecution stated that the probability of error was 1 in 21 billion. Hair and clothing fibers found at the crime scene and in Simpson's Bronco also linked Simpson to the crime scene, including the hair found on the blue knit cap matching Simpson's hair. FBI shoe print expert William J. Bodziak testified that bloody shoe prints found in Simpson's Bronco and at the crime scene matched a pair of expensive Bruno Magli shoes. However, it could not be proven that Simpson owned this pair of shoes, as the store where one employee testified to showing him the shoes did not have record of him actually purchasing them. Also, Bodziak could not say for certain that the shoe print in Simpson's Bronco definitely came from the same pair of shoes. The defense's case was built around reasonable doubt. They said that the case against OJ was compromised, contaminated, and corrupted. Officers Fung and Mazzola admitted that several mistakes were made while collecting evidence, such as not replacing gloves when handling new evidence and not storing DNA evidence in a refrigerated environment. The defense argued that this sloppy gathering of evidence greatly increased the probability of contamination. Microbiologist Dr. John Gerdes supported this claim, testifying that the LAPD's crime lab has substantial problems with contamination and therefore forensic PCR DNA matching is not reliable. He did not necessarily claim that this contamination did occur, just that it could have. The defense was also able to shed light on a history of racism in one of the primary investigators, Mark Furman. This discovery also put Furman at a large risk of perjury, as he had previously denied claims about any racial bias. This resulted in his lawyers advising him to invoke the Fifth when he went back on the stand. Another aspect of the defense's case was the infamous glove. The glove found at the crime scene was a key piece of evidence for the prosecution, and OJ's defense team used it to their advantage. When the defense called Mark Furman, the officer who found the glove at the scene, back to the stand, they asked him if he planted the glove.
Detective Furman, would you please resume the witness stand? All right, good afternoon, Detective.
Good afternoon, Your Honor.
You're reminded, sir, that you are still under oath. Mr. Ullman, you may proceed.
Detective Furman, was the testimony that you gave in this case completely truthful?
I wish to assert my Fifth Amendment privilege.
Have you ever falsified a police report?
I wish to assert my Fifth Amendment privilege.
Is it your intention to assert your Fifth Amendment privilege with respect to all questions that I ask you?
Yes.
I only have one other question.
What was that, Mr. Furman?
Detective Furman, did you plant or manufacture any evidence in this case?
I assert my Fifth Amendment privilege.
Furman's pleading of the Fifth allowed for the questions of police tampering to play a big role in the trial and create reasonable doubt in the minds of the jury. The most memorable moment of the trial came when Simpson was asked to try on the gloves, which did not fit.
This is People's 164A. Is that the right-hand glove?
Yes, sir.
All right.
Okay.
Deputy Jacks, would you just take a step back, please? Thank you. All right, records reflect that Mr. Simpson has both gloves. Yes. All right. Thank you, counsel.
Simpson's lawyer, Cochran, took advantage of this, saying a phrase that would stick with the jury when they made their verdict.
And the gloves didn't fit. Remember these words. If it doesn't fit, you must acquit. It's no disguise. It's no disguise. It makes no sense. It doesn't fit. If it doesn't fit, you must acquit.
After nearly 11 months of the trial, the jury arrived at the verdict on October 2nd, 1995. The jury decided to hold off on announcing it until 10 a.m. on October 3rd. The announcement that the verdict was going to be revealed led to many people surrounding the Los Angeles County Courthouse. Fearing that there would be race riots if O.J. was to be found guilty, all Los Angeles police officers were put on 12-hour shifts, with around 100 officers on horseback surrounding the courthouse. When the verdict was being announced, about 150 million people worldwide were watching, with about 57% of America waiting anxiously. The verdict was being broadcasted in Times Square, with people amassing below the giant screen to see the grand finale to this case. With everyone focused on the case, an estimated $480 million were lost in those few minutes. AT&T reported phone usage dropped by 60%, and the New York Stock Exchange trades decreased by 41%. Finally, at 10:07 on Tuesday, October 3rd, 1995, O.J. the Juice Simpson was acquitted on both counts of murder.
All right, Mr. Simpson, would you please stand and face the jury? Mrs. Robertson.
Superior Court of California, County of Los Angeles. In the matter of the people of the state of California versus Orenthal James Simpson, case number BA097211. We, the jury, in the above entitled action, find the defendant Orenthal James Simpson not guilty of the crime of murder in violation of Penal Code Section 187A, a felony upon Nicole Brown Simpson, a human being, as charged in count one of the information. Superior Court of the State of California, County of Los Angeles, in the matter of the people of the State of California versus Orenthal James Simpson. We, the jury, in the above entitled action, find the defendant Orenthal James Simpson not guilty of the crime of murder in violation of Penal Code Section 187A, a felony upon Ronald Lyle Goldman, a human being, as charged in count two of the information. We, the jury, in the above entitled action, further find the special circumstance that the defendant, Orenthal James Simpson, has in this case been convicted of at least one crime of murder of the first degree and one or more crimes of murder of the first or second degree to be not true. Signed this second day of October 1995, juror 230. Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, is this your verdict? So say you won, so say you all.
All right, counsel, Mr. Simpson, would you be seated, please? Just have it quiet in the courtroom, please.
While the verdict was being read, Lionel Cryer gave Simpson a raised fist salute, a sign for Black Power. The New York Times reported that Cryer was a former member of the Black Panther Party. The result of this verdict put tensions on race relations in the United States. A poll conducted shortly after the trial showed that 75% of white Americans thought that O.J. was guilty, while only 30% of Black Americans thought he was guilty. 10 years later, NBC conducted a poll in which the difference was even more noticeable, with 87% of white Americans thinking he was guilty and only 27% of Black Americans. In 2016, however, the demographic changed and the majority of people believed he was guilty. 83% of white Americans and 57% of Black Americans. The Los Angeles Police Department declined to re-examine the evidence due to the Fifth Amendment, which made O.J. not allowed to be tried a second time for the same crime.
Do you think O.J. Simpson is innocent or not?
Do I think he's innocent or not? I think there was a lot of compelling evidence that linked him to that crime. So the reason I'm saying that is because when I was in high school, one of the forensic scientists, Dr. Henry Lee, came to our high school and visited us, showed what forensic science is, and showed us evidence from the O.J. trial. So that, to me was pretty convincing, although in retrospect, he was a witness for the prosecution, and I didn't really know how that worked yet, so... But that has informed my opinions on it since that time.
For O.J. Simpson, life after the trial was nothing but tumultuous. Vision, dreams of passion. And all the while I think of you. A very strange reaction. The more I see, the more I do. Baby. Immediately following the murder trial, the family of Ron Goldman sued Simpson for wrongful death and battery. Simpson was unanimously found guilty and ordered to pay $33.5 million. Simpson had to default on the mortgage of his home of 20 years, and the house was subsequently demolished.
In this direction to the side of the garage where Mark Furman allegedly found the bloody glove. Some other points I should make about the blood. All the blood drops going along the side of Nicole's house towards her alley, the blood drops that are on this driveway going in various directions to or from my front door, the blood splattered Bronco, my blood splattered home. All of this blood constitutes less than 15 drops of blood, less than 15 drops. Now, when you talk about the estimated 1.5 cc's of blood that was missing from the blood vial, that would constitute something like 30 drops of blood.
In 2007, Simpson's book, If I Did It, was published. However, Simpson could not keep the rights to the book as he owed millions to the Goldman family. The book was subsequently modified, and the if was shrunken to make the title appear as I Did It. Other legal troubles followed Simpson throughout the 2000s. In 2001, Simpson's Miami house was searched due to a report that drug trafficking and money laundering operations were taking place in the house. Nothing was found except for equipment used to steal satellite television, leading to DirecTV suing Simpson for $33,000. In 2007, Simpson was caught stealing sports memorabilia at gunpoint while at the Palace Station Hotel. He was arrested and charged with multiple felonies, most notably robbery. Simpson pleaded not guilty, but was found guilty on all charges in 2008 and was sentenced to 33 years in prison. After serving 9 years in prison, Simpson was released on parole in 2017 and was made a free man in late 2021. As of 2022, the Goldman family says that Simpson owes $96 million due to the interest accumulated over 15 years. Over the last few years, O.J. Simpson has garnered an impressive following on social media, where he posts videos and talks about Nicole and the trial.
I don't know if this is considered a conspiracy, but this is basically a little series on if O.J. Simpson really did it or not.
Who knows? I guess we'll have to wait and see. Hey, Twitter world, this is yours truly. Hello, Twitter world, this is yours truly. Hey, Twitter world, it's me, yours truly. Hey, Twitter world.
We reached out to Mr. Simpson on Twitter and TikTok, where he declined to answer our questions. Straight up, honey, really, I'm asking. Most of these fellas think they be macking, but they be acting. Who they attracting with that line? What's your name? What's your sign? Soon as Mr. Simpson, we would greatly appreciate if you responded to us, or even just sent a video acknowledging us by May 24th. By May 24th. We have a deadline.
Thank you, sir.
We hope to see you at the premiere. Thank you.
The unlisted YouTube video premiere.
How do I stop it? Overall, the O.J. Simpson trial had a massive impact on both the legal system and American culture. Simpson's lawyer, Johnny Cochran, was one of the first lawyers to successfully build a defense around police violence and racism in the police force. Most notably, the reaction from the public to letters Nicole Brown wrote about her abuse, made public during the trial, led to the passage of the Violence Against Women Act in 1994. For better or worse, the O.J. Simpson trial was one of the most watched public court cases ever, with a verdict that still divides Americans today.
Hey, look, you asked me a question about something.
Yeah.
And there's no superficial answer.
No.
Unless I talk about
but
it, unless
I can hear
I
you're
get
bugged.
Deeper,
I can hear you're bugged.
Of course I am. I'm bugged to have to talk about it. Get my blood pressure going to have to. I don't think anybody could have gone through. I got totally screwed.
You know, I got things taken from me. I got me, to an extent, taken from me. My kids don't have a mother, and people want to ignore because of their, as far as I'm concerned, either ignorance, and in many cases, subconscious racism, won't look at the facts.
OJ, can't you say one thing? You know, I don't care whether you're black, white, or green. I really don't care. The bottom line is, you got off. You're innocent.
Thank you. Yeah. That is the bottom line, but that ain't the bottom line for so many people.
You're innocent. You got off. What kind of racism is that? You're free.
You know what? Let me say
something. You're walking around.
Let me say something.
What's your problem here? Just be free, be happy.
And once I get riled, sometimes, you know, you really get pissed, and I start thinking about stuff, and thinking about this and this and this and this. And
why do you go on?
Because I'm talking to you, and you got me riled up. You got me started on this subject. So if you promise that you will not ask me another question about the case.
I will never ask you again.
We won't have to talk about it anymore.
Just did you do it?
No, I didn't. Nope. Did not do it.
You ready?
Say Hillendale.
Right. Today we are at Hillendale Park. We're going to ask people about O.J. Simpson because a massive part of the trial was the media coverage, and we want to ask how that impacted them.
Fella, tried to run game on a fella, who's but wild with the trigger, shame on a fella, tried to run game on a fella, who's but soft.
We gained no insight on how OJ affected people's lives. Nobody wanted to talk to us. Maybe it was the suits, maybe it was the weather. I guess we'll never know.
I will be polite, and I will say, it's for our school project, but can you answer one question about O.J. Simpson for us? Just one, I swear. Promise.
Half of this documentary is going to be behind the scenes, and it's just going to be footage of this.
That is so creepy.
No, it's not.
It'll be fun.
Probably the green screen.
No, we don't need a green screen.